in this T-shirt.
Yeah,
yeah. Put it in your pocket, don't hit any buttons. Okay, I'll give you a presenter rights, okay?
Let me see that it will work or not. It is
it
not
has
taking.
What? Okay.
This is easy only, right?
Yeah. Pen drive mail, I
know? No, I will mail them, na? Okay. To anyone.
Give it that answer.
Or something is coming.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So notes will come, yeah, and I will.
It will come. Okay. Now you put it in presentation mode. Let's say five. And you can see. It will come. Now it comes here. You get your notes here.
Wait, right. Let me check.
Okay. You can extend. Keep it as it is, otherwise. Yeah. Okay.
1 second. Share kiya. This one.
No, this one. Fine, na? Dekho aap.
Yeah, I just want to check this.
Oh. Done. Shall I start? Start. Very less people are there, na? Okay. Thanks all for joining today's session. So today I am going to explain the Helix 2.0. So this year in symposium they have released a newer version of the Sitecore, is 2.0. The concept wise it is same, but they have improved a lot of things in the Helix in terms of the documentation as well as in terms of the tools. So I am going to explain that and how we need to use the Helix so that when you will start building the application, you need to think through the Helix implementation in terms of the information architecture as well as the solutioning. So that's once your application will grow at the later stage when you are in the production, so you will not face issue in the publishing or in the building. Because at the end when you will be writing a code, right? So you will start writing the code, but when it's come to the actual product release at the time of, at that time you will be trying to face a issue in terms of the content publishing. We have faced a many issue in content publishing as well as in the building time, because many people are seeing like that the Helix is means that create a different solution for each and every module. So they are following that thing. So I will explain how we need to use that. So this is the agenda, introduction, what's the new with the Helix and recommendation, and what are the available tools we can utilize it. So this is some synopsis about myself, I will explain. So myself Amit, and I am currently working with the Mindtree as a senior technical architect, and during the last 2 or 3 years I gained a knowledge in the Sitecore as well as XXA, JSS and some of the Helix principles. And in this session I will explain what's new in the Helix and identify the right candidate for the project feature and the foundation, how we need to write that. Suppose if you received any requirement, how you need to start from the scratch, that I will explain, and the other things, tools. So I am hoping that everyone will be aware about the Helix. So not the much, but some overview you should have to understand how the Helix principle will work. So here I will give the brief introduction. So Sitecore come up with some of the architecture principle called a Helix. So what they are telling, that the dependency should be present at the lower level, at the foundation, as the name suggests. and on top of that feature will be there. These are not the physical entities. You can create the physical entities as well as you can create the virtual boundaries in your application to create the or apply the Helix principles. So project means that whatever the things you need to present to the end user, like a presentation layer, that will be coming inside the project, like a layout, or you are creating the .chtml file related to the your layout, like you are creating any application and you are having a suppose 10 website, and for each website you are having a different page layout, so you can place that into a project. Or suppose you are having any layout which needs to be reshared with the different website, that also needs to be come inside the project. And the feature will be depicting here is the module or the things which is going to solve your business requirement. So those things will be coming into the feature. And foundation here, as the name suggested, that the things which is a more stable things, that will come inside the foundation. So it's not like that if you are having any functionality and that is going to be very stable, you will push that into the foundation. You do not need to do like that, otherwise you will be at the end you will be creating a more than 10 or 20 projects in your solution. And as per my understanding, I am depicting means making a project layer as a presentation, feature as a business, and the foundation as a data. In typical ASP.NET 3-tier architecture, we are having a presentation layer, we are having a data access layer, and the business layer we will be dividing into this data layer we will be dividing into a two things. One is the data access layer, one is the service layer. So you can think about that also. So before me moving to this, can anyone explain me that why we need to use the Helix, if anyone can tell? Yes. And any other thing?
Easy upgrade, modular approach.
See, the Helix principle is based on the solid principle only, like a loose coupling. And it will be helpful for the modularity, scalability, but it is nothing to do with the upgrade, because upgrade is not directly connected with the architecture principle. You are doing the upgrade for the product, you are not going to upgrade the principles, right? So upgrade will depend upon how you have done the implementation, like you have not overridden the out of the box pipeline, means if you have updated the existing functionality to fulfill your directly fulfill your requirement without doing the patching, or you have updated any template in the Sitecore system templates without extending them. So in those cases your upgrade will fail, right? So those things also will be, we can implement it with the help of a principle, Helix principle, or with the help of a solid principles. So last year Sitecore opened a one experience survey. So with the help of that survey, they have taken a survey from the developer as well as from the business user and the clients, and they are keep taking the survey as well as interview of the developer or the business user or the client, and they are taking the opinion in the Slack channel also and Twitter also. They are keep asking the questions. Suppose if they are going to implement or update any new things in the Helix principle, so they will be taking a feedback from the developer community. As well as in the GitHub, they are having this feature RFC. So if you want to implement or improve anything into the Helix principles, so you can raise a RFC request, and that can be reviewed by the Sitecore team, and they can discuss with you and they can update the documentation. Maybe there are the some principles or the languages which is written in the Helix that is not matching with the actual principle, like a solid principles. So if they are agreed of the mutual understanding, and they are going to update that also. And these are the some of the current RFC requests which they have approved it, and their own product team is raising a request, as well as the other Sitecore community member are coming and telling that the things which are written in the Helix, which it is not matching with the principle. And these are the snapshot of the survey they have taken is last year. So these are the inputs from the developers. So with the help of that, they are keep pushing this things into a, whenever any client is coming to use the Sitecore, they are mainly emphasizing on we are having a Helix principle. So how they are getting the feeling when the number of developer will start increasing the use of the Helix principles, with that way they are telling to the client. And this is the satisfaction of the developers, not much. So there are a lot of changes done in the Helix. So in terms of the change log, whatever they have done it, so these are the listing of the change log this year. So this is released in the November 5th only. This made available to the public. So what they added, that they have changed the guiding and solution architecture of the Helix, as well as introduction sections they have updated. And one major thing is that earlier people were confused with the Helix and the habitat. So they have removed the habitat word from most of the documentation, because habitat is the implementation and people are wrongly using the habitat in place of the Helix. So they have removed that. And also they have introduced a, as I was telling, that it's based on the solid principles. So that is also created by the Uncle Bob. So the, what they have changed, that on the basis of the solid principles, there is a one more principle is called the package principles, that is emphasizing how you need to virtually package your modules in the any of the application, not the Sitecore. So now all the documentation, everywhere you will be see the package. So they have updated that in the appendix section as well as in the introduction section. So these are the new definition they have added, the introduction of the Sitecore. So they have clearly mentioned that it's a recommend practice convention and the solution architecture to make a Sitecore product. So as you said earlier itself, like why we are using the Sitecore, so that all of the project developed by the any company or the developer will follow the same naming convention, so that it is easy to provide the support from the Sitecore side, as well as if any new team member or the developer is joining your team, you do not need to give the long training. If the everything is followed proper, so you can the person can start working on that. And also they have mentioned that why we need to follow the Helix to reduce the technical depth. The technical depth meaning here is that when we are assigning any work to any person, right? So generally what happened, that in every company we are following the pyramid in the team, like one senior, one technical lead and the module lead and the developer. So what we will do to save the cost, we will start giving the work to the all are the senior software engineer without discussing it, right? So what will happen, that to fulfill the requirement they will write the code, right? But at the later stage when we will be start facing the issues in terms of the performance or performance or any issue or the bug came with respect to the any other part of the application, like a content reissue or config issue, at that time we are able to find that the code which is written there, it is not as per the standard. So those things are named as a technical depth, and they are the ways to identify those technical depth. So this is the principle of the package design. So what they are telling, that it's a conceptual framework for managing a package boundaries. So package bounding means that how you are logically defining your packages, like which things will be packed together and pushed into the production or into your solution. So all these things you will be finding in the new Helix documentation. And earlier you will be not able to find the details related to the Sitecore commerce. So now they have added a architectural principle for the Sitecore commerce in the Helix, they have included. This is solution structure. they have also introduced a alternate Visual Studio solution structure, which I was talking earlier, that it's not mandatory that for each and every module you will create a application or the Visual Studio solution. So they are coming up with the different alternate approach also. They have explained in the appendix section how you can modularize your Visual Studio solution with the logical boundaries. With the help of the static code analysis rule, you can identify that these things are following the Helix principle or not, like a circular dependency, right? So if you will write a code in the .NET and you will try to make a circular dependency, it will give you a error messages. So same way, they have created a fxcop rule also. And now I told that the habitat is removed. Now the new repository came like a Helix example. So you will be finding a new website with the different type of widgets, and the URL is also have been changed to that. Okay, and also in the Helix, how we need to organize the tedious content structure and how we need to organize the common commerce related business object, they have also updated in the Helix documentation. So they are also currently working on the many of the options related to the Sitecore Helix, which will be, they are going to release in the mid March. So they are also continuously working on the new things in the Helix. So any questions till this point? So we need to write it. So there are the many clients nowadays, they, because that Sitecore 8.2 support is going to end, I think, this December, right? So now their main worry is to move to the newer version, right? So there are two ways. First is that you will do the complete refactoring, because maybe that will be on the web forms, right? Maybe.
What happened?
Now fine.
Hello.
So nowadays what they are doing, that they need to do the complete refactoring from the web form to the MVC, or they can do a lift and shift. It means that if they do not have the budget, they need to move the existing code base web forms code into the new by changing the binaries and the other patch configs. That will require a less effort and the less amount of money. If they are having a budget and the time, they can do the complete refactoring and they can follow the Helix principle, because once you are moving from a normal development means three-tier architecture to the Helix-based architecture, so you can utilize, as per my knowledge, you can utilize only 40% of the code base. 60% will be refactoring or the new implementation you have to do that. So while you are giving or working that type of project, or you are giving the estimation, so you need to clearly articulate those assumptions to the client, so that they are aware about that, what they are going to do that. Because maybe it will be a more time if you will use the, if you are using the MongoDB, right? So that is the main pain area, because 9 they have moved to the till 9.2 they have moved to the SQL Server, but in 9.3 itself they are having a MongoDB. You can explicitly use the MongoDB instead of the SQL, but you need to see that how much the update is coming from 8.2 to the 9.3. so those are the things we need to consider. No, that's why I'm telling you, people are having a wrong perception that you need to create a folder. It's not like that. If you are having old structure also, that's why everything is required at time, right? So if they are telling lift and shift, you do not need to do anything. You just need to change the .NET binaries and the Sitecore binaries and push it, right? But if you wanted to do the refactoring, then refactoring comes into a two way. One is that you need to do the physical solution structure change as well as the information architecture. So that will increase the time. So you do not need to go via that way. Otherwise, it will take much time. So next topic is Helix recommendations and conventions. So I explained that Helix is based on the package design. So this is the principle of the package cohesion, right? So they are having 6 points, and the first 3 points is explaining how the package or the content will be going into a one package. Okay, so first rule is that the reuse release equivalency principle. So I have tried to explain in a simple things. So for example, you are having a navigation itself, right? And that navigation can involve a main navigation, footer, fat footer, breadcrumbs, or a left navigation, right navigation, right? So I have seen that people are creating a header type of things, and inside that they are placing a navigation. For footer, they are creating a footer module and they are creating the solution. Same applies to the, suppose you are having a different requirement like an article, you are having a news, you are having a blogs, not blogs, press releases, right? So those are the same entities, right? But people are creating a different solution in the Visual Studio as well as in the content tree. So they need to know that what is the purpose of that particular requirement, right? On the basis of that business requirement, we need to club the module and we need to give the name as per the business requirement, not what you are going to actually implement it. So same, one more example is that if anyone have worked on the insurance domain, they are having a quotation management. Quotation can be a get quotation, quick quotation, and there is a one more is called a detailed quotation, right? So all are interrelated and you are going to reuse some part of that, right? So in those cases, you can just name it as a quotation management, but the business purpose of that is quotation management, right? So same applies here. The main purpose is that navigation. So instead of creating a different modules, you can club it. And the best example, if you will dot pick the XXA, this binaries, so you will see that they are having a composite module. So that will contain all the promo content, promo, page content, tabs, those type of components, which is serving the purpose to display a static content wherever the you need to display the media, like a carousel, accordion, right, where you are giving the information. So they named it as a composite. And for that, what we need to do, that we can create a same solution structure. We can move a common item, like here the common item is like that. Name, URL, it needs to open in the new navigation. These are the common attributes that you can place in the foundation layer as a base template for this particular thing. And rest, you can create a feature level thing, like you can create a interface template where you can inherit a navigation itself, or you can create a some sort of a new template item which you will be using in your information architecture to create the item. So the main thumb rule here is that you do not need to create a different feature for that, and try to take a common data and place into the foundation. The other is the common reuse principle, right? Classes that are not bound to each other with class relationship should not be in the same package. Okay, so I was explaining that you can create a means feature things into the feature, which are generally we are donating with the underscore, that those are the interface template, and these are the login means that which is inheriting this item, right? So you can directly create a item with this thing, but there are the some cases in the Helix, you will find that there are the some items which are present in the project layer itself, like inside the common data source template, right? So you can place it there, but that is a optional thing, right? It means that the things which are present in the project layer, like if you want to implement a site specific changes to any functionality, those things will comes into the project layer, right? And people are creating a data source template there itself, as well as the template inside the feature also. So it's up to us like that. So whatever is the common things that we need to place in under a one feature, and if it is serving a different purpose not related to the feature, that will go to the project layer or the any layer, other layer. The common closure principle: the classes in a package should be close together against the same kind of changes. A changes that affects a package affects all the classes in that package and no other packages. It means that the things which are tightly coupled, which we saw in the other example, first principle, like a main navigation, footer navigation, that things needs to be clubbed into a one. For example, if you are going to add a new navigation, like a side navigation, right? So in those cases, you just need to update the one feature only. You are not going to affect the other feature, right? Because you already identified that these are the functionalities which will stay together with the help of first principles, right? So the same way, if you are adding a new one, you are going to touch this only. You do not need to test the other modules in the application. So that's why it's called a common closure principle. So what we need to do in this case, maybe we need to add a new fields to serve the side navigation, as well as we need to write a new CHTML file to do that. So in those cases, we are just going to touch only this particular module. So it's also a one part of the solid principles, where they have written that the module is for the extend, it's not for the change, right? So here we are extending them, we are not changing them. So other three item is that last three principles define how packages, that is a module in the Helix, should interact with one another, the dependency thing. The acrylic dependency means the circular dependency. So for example, you have seen that you are having a products that is using the offers, right? And that offer itself, if you will click on that, it will display articles, and articles is again connected with the products, right? So those are the circular dependencies that we need to avoid it while creating the application or the module. Otherwise, what will happen, that the issues at the later stage, when you are publishing the products item, right, and you have given the references of that, so if you will check the related items, right, so it will take each and every item. Suppose you are having a products, you have selected a one offer, but what it will do, it will take all the items from the offers, and it will check that if there is any update done is not that, and then again it will go to the articles, and it will check that what are the products is being used there, right, and it will do a processing of that. So with the due to that, your the publishing queue time will increase, and your application will start throwing the 500 errors. So that you have to avoid it. The other item is the stable dependencies principle. Code should depend in the direction of stability. So it's not like that you will directly skip this, or the feature is depending upon the foundation, because foundation means here is that the things which are the stable things. For example, you are having a three features which are sharing a suppose 30% and 20% of the item. So it's not like that you will, and after that it is not going to use by the other application or the another functionality. It's not like that you will put that 20% into the foundation and create a solution for that, right? So it's better to keep it with the feature itself, because in near future also it is not going to depend upon that. For example, if there is a functionality where you need to display a news feed, right, but that news feed is specific to the news module only, it is not going to use by the any other module. So what you can do, that if you want a more modularity, you will create a one module in the foundation layer where you will create a object which will access your service layer third party. It will give you a data, then you are with DI, you are accessing that. People are doing that, but it is directly connected with that feature only, right? It is not going to connect with your quotation or any other thing, right? So it's better to keep it with the feature only, right? So don't create a separate things. And also dependency wise means that, for example, if you are having a complete service layer and you need to fetch a data from a different APIs, right? And the news feed is there also, and quotation is there also, and you are having any form where you are submitting the data to the other backend system, right? So in those cases, what you can do there, you can create a one service layer which will just receive the service URL from top, and rest of the object making things like a what type of service URL needs to be built and the other things needs to be done at a foundation layer, but the actual service call will be happening at a feature layer, right, with the help of a dependency injection by calling the objects. So with that way you can refactor, but it's not like that for a news you will create a different foundation, for a quotation you will create a different foundation. It's not like that. You need to extract the service calling mechanism into a one system and you need to refactor it. The other is the stable abstraction principle, SAB. A package should be as abstract as it is stable, right, which I already explained is that. So the things which are going to change, for example, you are accessing any system like a SAP system or the HANA, maybe I have worked only one time, but sometime what will happen that they are keep increasing the or the adding or deleting the attributes from your the vendor things where you are giving the order. Suppose they will increase one more attributes, right? So if that type of implementation if you have placed in the foundation layer, right, so what will happen that you need to keep updating that, and then you need to validate all of the application or all the binaries of your application. So instead of that, you can place those things into your feature itself, because that is not going to use by the any other thing. So that is the meaning of this. Any question till those six principles? Okay, now the helix smells means how we can identify that how much technical depth or the whatever the code we have written is correct or not. So the code smell means that in computer programming, a code smell is any characteristic in the code, source code of a program that possibly indicates a deeper problem. Issue can be duplicated code, forced uses of overcomplicated design patterns. There the sometimes what will happen that you do not need to apply any design pattern or the any you can say the design principle to write any code, but you know that you will apply that, like a DI. Some cases you do not need to add a dependency injection, but you are adding a dependency injection, right? And the dependency, large classes, one class is serving all the things, like many people are creating a utility class, right? So utility class generally is a static class and it will be having all the helper classes, right? So you are making that class large. So if any issue will happen, you need to thoroughly see that what are the issues in that or in that solution. And method having so many parameters, long methods, these are the things which will tell you the code smells. And same things we are having the helix smells, like habitat is not a starter kit. They are keep emphasizing on that. Unwanted code, for example, you have added a habitat solution and you have copy pasted it, but what will happen that there are the many code like asset optimization, or you are having a metadata, or there are the cases like a site extension type of things. You are not using it, but you know that it's provided by the Sitecore and you have added into your solution, right? But if you will check the references of that, it is not being used anywhere. And the redundant code, so the things, if you follow the package solution, all the redundant code needs to be present into a one place, right? For example, if they are the best example is that you will be accessing a image URL and that you will be accessing in a 10 places in your application. But every time to access the image field, you are writing a same replication of the code every method. So it's better to place it in the Sitecore extension. And not proper refactoring and the module identification. So suppose if you will create a new module everywhere, every time. And other are the anti-pattern principles. Database, circular dependency, constant interface. Many people are to access this template ID, they are creating a constant. So generally it will should be present in the structure class. Which I already explained, habitat cargo cult. It means that you have written a code like a cargo, very big code, like asset optimization, multi-site, indexing, everything you have included. But in your solution, when you are accessing the item, you are simply calling a Sitecore dot items and you are accessing from that, you are not using the search. So in those cases, there is no use of the indexing solution, right? So we need to avoid those things in our solution. One is this feature refactoring, like instead of creating a accordion carousel tabs flips as a different module, because those are serving as a same purpose, right? So combine it and place it into the composite or any like you can say that interactive content module. And how we can identify that it is a candidate for a new feature or not? So should I create a new feature? Does it fall into the business domain of an existing feature? That's why Sitecore is emphasizing we need to see the feature in terms of the business domain or the business functionality, not like that main navigation, side navigation. What is the purpose of that? Yes, no, and not sure. On the basis of that, we can identify that it needs to be created a new module or not. FAT Foundation and the FAT project, which I already explained, like a FAT Foundation is meaning that you are adding unwanted projects or the unwanted interfaces, template and everything into the foundation layer, right? And you are increasing the size of the foundation binaries as well as you are increasing the boundary for the package itself. If it is having more than one responsibility, then we need to place them in a different things, or any feature is dependent on a one functionality, then only it will be a right candidate for the foundation. And this is the flow to identify that the candidate is for a foundation module or not. That is the flow we can use that. So I will share the slide, you can go through. Is it? Because I am not having a time. Like this, product details. Suppose you are fetching a product details from a one place and you are displaying it. Suppose you are receiving the ID and you are fetching a database, but you have created a product details foundation. But it's a no need, right? Because product details is serving the one purpose, to display the product details on the basis of ID. So instead of writing a complete project for that, you can add a data or a code which will interact with your Sitecore with the help of a ID. You can place them into the foundation, not the complete product details project. So this is the things like that. If you are added a more solution into the solution, into a Visual Studio solution, like a 100 projects, so when they will start building, it will take a minimum 2 hours or 3 hours, right? So we need to avoid those things also, and this is also one of the anti-patterns while you are writing the code. So things to consider while you are starting any new project, any module, always be thinking about the solution architecture. Means what is the technology stack you are using it and what is the current implementation. For example, if you are writing a your application is using the plain vanilla Sitecore, but you receive a some corporate site, it's not like that you will just start use the XXA because it is suggested by the Sitecore. You have to see that what is the long term future of the XXA by including into your project. It's not like that you will be pushing that, maybe there are the some conflict will come, but that will come into the production. Or what is the future means of your client, they are trying to move all their legacy application into the XXA or a JSS or not, right? So you need to thoroughly thought through what are the things you are going to use. And you need to understand the guidelines, which are the most important. They are not telling that you will strictly follow the Helix. Any principle which is a providing a loose coupling, you need to follow that. And you can use the Helix also. That is a recommendation. And these are the tools details they have provided, Sitecore TDS, FX Corp role for Sitecore Helix. So you do not need to, I think, write a, I have not used this, but what they are telling that if you will use this FX Corp role, static code analyzer, it can identify that if any dependency is there, so it will give you that virtual boundary is present or not in your solution by following the Helix principles. There is a Helix publishing pipeline is also created by one of the Sitecore community member, and cape.sitecore is for the CI/CD if you have to implement it on the basis of Helix principle. And the SIF is also there, and nowadays they are telling instead of using the gulp you have to use the MS build because it will decrease the build time. And this template is present in the Visual Studio. If you will use that, it will automatically create the feature foundation and those things automatically. You do not need to manually go and create a feature solution, then you need to change the physical location and you need to rename it. It will automatically take care. And for the Greenfield project, they have created a very you can say that the project for the Greenfield project, instead of earlier using the big heavy the habitat solution, they have created a simple Helix based solution. You can use that as a starter kit, but for your reference purpose. But it's not like that you will use that into your production or the client specific. You will change this Helix based dot website to your client name dot website, so you do not need to do that. So I connected with the many people in the community, like Nick and Derek. They provide a Helix 2.0 this presentation. So what they are telling that from a community perspective, we need to educate the client what is the benefit of using the Helix. It's not like that client will come and they will start pushing you use the Helix, right? Because client is not aware that what is the purpose of Helix. So you need to educate them and you need to buy a time from them to implement that. Any questions? Yes. See, the good example of a custom pipeline is that there is a, for example, you are writing any authentication and authorization module, right? That is be a part or a foundation of your application, because without that you do not need to display a secured content to your of your website to the user, right? So in those cases, those things needs to be present in your foundation pipeline, because you have created a login module, right? That login module will be having a HTTP request. That HTTP request may be you will be using for a other type of a feature also. For example, you need to identify that if user is coming from this region, you need to redirect. I am giving a simple example, right? There also you will be fetching a HTTP request to find a initial touch point of your application, right? So it means that those two modules are dependent on your HTTP request pipeline, right? So in those scenario, it needs to become into the foundation.
Okay.
With that way you have to think. But if there is a publishing pipeline, right? So publishing pipeline is not a feature, right? It's a base things which will be supporting your application to be run, and it is required by whole application as a, you can say that the important point, right? So those things will come into the foundation. Custom sitemap is, custom sitemap